calling here. We'll do some with some sort of icebreaker. Okay, we'll get to know each other. Hopefully by the time some of the seats will get filled up. Okay, then we don't know each other. So let us know each other. First, let me explain myself. I am Narasimha Prabhu. I come from 30 plus years of experience in software IT industry, especially in telecom software. I started my career in C-Dot and then went on to work in multiple other companies, and went through a journey of career in IT industry. I've seen ups and downs in technology downturns, technology upturns, IT industry changes, all those things I've seen. But my interest in spirituality has been there for a long time. Since childhood, I had a good exposure of yoga, meditation, some exposure to Vedanta. So like that, I have grown up. It's more of a deep interest for whatever reason. And gradually it has opened up a deeper inner understanding, which is possibly not in the books. Okay, it comes from the deeper inner opening. As you mature in your spiritual journey, something opens up inside, something gives a different insights, a newer viewpoints of life. So those started coming up. And some people, my friends and colleagues, used to come to me for consultancy, rather counseling. Okay, typical IT industry problems: job stress, marriage, okay, work stress, work home balance. How do I make mine peaceful? So informally some group started. Informally some people came and asked some questions. I gave some answers. They felt happy. They said called some other people. So gradually started growing into a small group. I thought, okay, these groups are coming, individually they are coming, let me start giving them a formal education. So I started some weekend classes. It all started back in 1995, 96, that time. So gradually over a period of time, by the word of mouth, it started growing. Some people started coming. Then some of my students started teaching others. Like that, it had grown into a small informal group called Atma Jyoti Satsang or Light of Self Foundation. I have talked on a variety of spiritual topics. There are about 2,000 to 3,000 talks of mine available on YouTube. All are open. Okay, so people ask some questions, I give some answers, right or wrong, whatever I know. Okay, and my policy is to keep it open so that people can access it on the internet, YouTube. Then some of my students started teaching their own started conducting their classes nearby, and they have their own small satsang. These are not a big organized activity, okay? It's all informal, grows by itself. So like that, then many people started attending the classes which I conduct through internet, Google
Hangouts.
So like that, it has started gradually growing. And in the process, I also have matured, I have also learned teaching, okay? I didn't get any formal education in teaching in the spiritual subject. So life has given me some good amount of education, and then I'm sharing with people who needs it. That's how it is. Okay. I have talked on Upanishads, Bhagavad Gita. Right now I'm working on the teachings of Brahma Sutra, which is one of the Prasthanatriya, the great text of spirituality. So what I found is that many of these texts are very, very complex. Very, very complex. Of course, any person from Sanatana Dharma is supposed to know only three aspects: Upanishad, Bhagavad Gita and Brahma Sutra. So they have become so complex in many of these teachings that arguments, counter arguments, it is very, very difficult for anybody to get into that. So first I started with Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita is for common man. It's very difficult to, they'll attend classes here and there. Then what I did, I selected 108 slokas of Bhagavad Gita. And said, these 108 slokas, selected slokas, if you study, you get a glimpse of Bhagavad Gita. So then people found, okay, I don't have to study so much, so let me start with 108. So that's where many people started, and they started growing into teachers of Bhagavad Gita. Similarly, I was looking at Brahma Sutra. Brahma Sutra is a fairly complex text. It's not for a common man type of thing. Even though it's supposed to be designed, it's supposed to be for a common person. So I thought, okay, let me do a little bit of work on that to simplify and communicate to masses. That's where I'm working. And I conduct classes on every day morning. So this class are broadcast and they're available on YouTube. People access them. Some people transcribe them. Some people give a voice over to other languages. Like that, a group of people who are committed, dedicated seekers of spirituality or participants of spirituality is working. All voluntary, no commercial, no nothing. It's all simply growing by itself. So that's about brief introduction to myself. Thank you. You have any questions? Yes.
To learn all these things, Sanskrit becomes mandatory. Is there anything?
So yeah, this is also I found one challenge. Okay. The Sanskrit is a good language. Okay. Many of the spiritual truths can be communicated in Sanskrit much better way compared to other languages. It's like a technical terms. Many of the technical terms you don't have find a equivalent in other language. And if you translate it, it becomes lose the meaning. For example, one simple word called dharma. Okay, dharma is one word, and if you translate into any other language, it will lose the meaning because you can't understand the context, and it gives totally different meaning. So this happens to everything. For example, sannyasi, a monk. So the common usage of word and the real meaning of that word gets deviated. So the Sanskrit understanding gives a depth in the understanding. Probably you do first hand work. Now if you don't do that, I don't have a Sanskrit background, then you rely on somebody who has done their work. Okay, so that you don't get misled. Okay, so there can easily get misled in this because they're all very subtle and precise. Okay, so rely on somebody who has done their work if you don't have depth of. So typically use the texts where somebody has done the work and you go to his English meaning. Trust the source at least, right? Now for the purpose of study of scriptures, you don't have to go to Sanskrit now. So what I typically do is I'll make all things in English. I'll write in English and footnote I'll give the Sanskrit meaning and split and give it so that you can always refer. I found that if I keep using common Sanskrit terms there, people feel uncomfortable. So I use, you can go to my blog site, okay, you can see. So I have written on the blogs on many topics, and some lot of thousands of talks are available in spirituality. If you like it, you refer it. Okay. So the question is, if I have to do original work, Sanskrit is mandatory. If I have to do original work. If I can't do original work, if I have to trust some person, okay, this person has done really good job, then follow it. Otherwise, you can get into misleading situation. Any other question?
Yeah. So can you elaborate on the complexity of the texts in a way? As you were earlier telling, certain texts are complex, whereas certain are meant for the common man.
See, the complexity is not in text. So the complexity is not text. Okay? The complexity is the human mind. The spiritual texts are actually, the spirituality is one of simple and it's actually applicable to us directly in life. Okay. Now when you try to explain to somebody, the ability of the person to explain, that ability of the person to listen, that brings the complexity. Now, easier to explain anything objective in nature. For example, if I say this is a mobile phone, which brand, which model, it's easy. But let us say I start explaining some subtle things, it becomes difficult, communication becomes difficult. Got it? For example, let us say a blind person is there, and he wants to know what is white. Okay? So a person is blind, and somebody has to communicate to him what is white. How does he communicate whiteness to the blind person? Because whiteness, is it in the subject, is it in the board, or is it in the object, perceiver, right? So now he goes to a man who has eyesight, please explain me what is whiteness. That person says, whiteness, come, I'll show you. And he takes him to walk, see, touch this is white. The blind person says, oh, I got it, the whiteness means hard, like hard. So then, no, it's not hard. This guy, he understands that this person has misunderstood. It's not hard. Come, it's milk, it's like milk. So what is milk? Oh, I understand. Whiteness means wetness. Okay, now, no. Whiteness is not hard, whiteness is not wet. It's like a duck, white duck. How is white duck? Oh, I understood. Whiteness means hard, whiteness means wet, whiteness means crooked. So, when you want to communicate your subjective experience, okay, any amount of words you use can mislead you. Okay, so this is the challenge of spiritual communication since ages. So, and also what happens is the terminology used in certain age becomes non-relevant or difficult to comprehend in certain other age. Okay. For example, in ancient time, they didn't have a PowerPoint, TV, projector. They used fire as an example. Now we have not seen fire also, only fire engine using. So communication becomes difficult because of the time frame. They have communicated something, they found something, they communicate to the audience, and the audience also different problems now. That time, okay, their social situations different, the questions were different, context was different, the spiritual truth is same. Whom to communicate, how to communicate becomes changes. So now if I communicate the same thing to today age, the audience cannot get a context. So then fight starts. My truth, this is my truth, this is my truth. So that's where the truth is same all the point of time. Nobody can change the truth. As long as man is there, the truth is same, the spiritual truth. But the communication varies from time to time. You understand? That's where the importance of our teachers or masters comes into picture. The masters will come to that age and reinterpret the communication, not the content. For example, when Jesus Christ taught, he taught the father is like a shepherd. He will take care of all sheep. So he was talking to shepherds. He cannot take any other language. Whereas Sri Shankaracharya is talking, he was talking in very sophisticated logic of Advaita, and the logic is so precise and sharp. Okay? So now the communication, truth is being communicated. But the audience are now here, the people who are sitting in Shankara's audience were very, very highly intellectual and philosophers. The communication, the way you communicate, and if you talk a shepherd's language to those people, they'll run away. And for a shepherd, you touch philosophy, he'll run away. So the context, the content, the communication changes. So this is what challenges speak out. And the language of communication also makes a difference. Sanskrit is a very, very different type of language, okay, compared to other languages. Why it's different? It is not an objective language, it is a subjective language. You mean to what to say? Let me give you an example. When I say moon, what does it mean to you? English word moon?
Satellite.
Look at a dictionary. What does the dictionary say?
Satellite.
An object going around the earth is the moon. Whereas in Sanskrit, the moon has some 10 different names. And nothing related to the object there, sitting there. It says, there is an object there, but your subjective experience is this. It speaks about your subjective experience, not about the object. Chandrama, it says. Chandrama means seeing which beauty of which your mind melts. Where is the moon then? So, the Sanskrit was a language which is used to communicate the subjective experience. And English is a language which is used for communicating objective experience. Now, with English, you try to explain spiritual truths, then there will be confusion. Okay. Another example. If you want to, let's say many people want to go to heaven, they prefer not to go to hell. They find a dictionary in English dictionary. What is heaven? In English dictionary? What do you call as a place called heaven?
Probably where there are no troubles and enjoy it.
Enjoy and beautiful girls dancing. And maybe liquor and wine available. Okay? So now, this is English language. In Sanskrit, if you go, there's a word called Nakam. Nakam means Na Akam. Akam means suffering. where there is no suffering is Swarga, heaven. So it's not a place. It may be here. So the Sanskrit converts everything object into subjective. English converts everything subject into objective.
I mean,
see, I'm not a scholar. I know Sanskrit to the extent of decoding. So I can't consider myself a Sanskrit scholar. I studied Sanskrit in my schools, and my teachers are so good. They give me enough background to understand. So it's a different language. But then, lack of Sanskrit education doesn't stop you from anything. Rely on a good source. Okay. Then, at some point it will come to you, then even the good source will start questioning, is this the real meaning? Then you need that technical capability. Okay? So this is the context. Okay. Now, you people are gathered here, and what do you want to listen from me? Tell me. I have given a topic called real and unreal. Okay? So I think this place is for real, unreal. Not real and unreal. Real life and real life, they are very different. Or I don't know whether they are same. For you it's same, right? So I give a topic called real and unreal without knowing who are the people coming. Now you tell me what do you expect from me, I'll talk on that topic. If I know. Other than movies. So what do you want to know?
You want to know what is real?
You want to know? Huh?
What is not real and what is real?
You want to know what is real and what is not real? Anybody else?
The topic sounded interesting by itself, so.
Okay.
Curiosity.
Okay, good. So, let us understand definition of real. Right? We'll all go by what our ancestors said, okay? Now, let us start with a invocation. Let us chant Omkara 3 times together.